Tuesday night in the Kosovo capital of Pristina. The NATO peacekeepers from KFOR are on reassurance patrol.
By the way, please.
Corporal Kevin Martin of the Royal Irish Regiment is acting as a social worker.
What's
she saying?
Oh, she's afraid.
Yeah, of course she is.
Lubica and Dobrica are in their 80s, and they're trembling with fear. Albanians have threatened to kill them. The bruise on Lubica's forehead is from a recent confrontation.
The lady is saying that they are not against the law. If the law said that they must leave, they will.
The law does not say they have to leave. They are free to live here like anybody else.
Free in principle, but not in practice. Intimidation has been systematic. More than half the Serbian residents have fled Kosovo. The war that NATO fought to stop the ethnic cleansing of Albanians has created a new cycle of revenge. Now the Serbs are the main victims, and that's a striking reversal of the power balance in the province these past 10 years. How the Serbs lost Kosovo is a complex story of failed international diplomacy and misjudgments that led to the worst war in Europe in half a century. In March, the US Special Envoy Richard Holbrook was sent on a final mission to negotiate with Yugoslavia's President Slobodan Milosevic.
Hello, I have a brief statement to make. President Clinton and Secretary Albright sent our delegation here to Belgrade on a mission of peace at a time of escalating violence in the region.
Holbrook persuaded Milosevic to end the Bosnia War in 1995. Now he threatened a new war unless the oppression of the Albanians was stopped.
At about 10 in the morning on March 23rd, I went in to see him alone. And we sat alone in this vast room in the White Palace, surrounded by his art. And normally there were other people in the meetings. And I said to him, "You understand what will happen when I leave here today if you don't change your position?" And he said, "Yes, you will bomb us." And there was a dead silence in the room, uncharacteristic. And I said, "I want to be clear with you. It will be," and I used three words I'd worked out very carefully with the US military, "it will be swift, it will be severe, it will be sustained." And he said, in a very matter-of-fact way, very flat, "No more engagement, no more negotiations. I understand that. You will bomb us."
Thirty hours later, we climbed atop of our hotel roof and watched as the first missiles of Operation Allied Force slammed into the outskirts of Belgrade. NATO had planned a short war.
I think there's no doubt at all that NATO believed that this would be a very quick military operation. I think 2 or 3 days is perhaps a little much of an exaggeration, but certainly they thought it would be over in a week.
I made a speech in the House of Lords in which I said that bombing would not end it in 3 days. It would stiffen the Serb resistance and it would cause much more hardship to the Kosovan Albanians if we hadn't done it.
The big difference was the estimate of whether it was likely to be a two-day bombing campaign or a two-week bombing campaign. And the real underlying reason for that was that everybody believed that Bosnia had shown in 1995 that if only you bombed for 2 weeks, you would have peace.
But NATO had miscalculated. Kosovo was more important to most Serbs, and certainly to Milosevic, than Bosnia. While journalists from NATO countries were either expelled or advised to leave, we were able to keep reporting. Now it's time to return.
I've been looking forward to this day for some time, going back to Belgrade. Having reported the war there for 3 months, I'm keen to feel what peace is like in the city and to talk to the government ministers about the war they fought, about the genocide in Kosovo, the forcible expulsion of perhaps a million people, and most particularly about the lies that they told the Yugoslav people.
Živadin Jovanović is the foreign minister of Yugoslavia. He's an old-style socialist. On the day we met, he'd just come from Milosevic's White Palace. And he was as ready as ever to argue the claim that NATO's campaign had breached international law.
Thank you for doing this.
You could hardly expect a sovereign country, and especially this country with well-known history, to surrender, indeed, with and because of threats, because of absolutely unacceptable positions which were not justified by law, by standards, by moral principles, etc.
Mr. Jovanović tries to characterize Yugoslavia as the righteous David up against the Goliath-like NATO.
The mightiest military organization in one hand, and here you have one very tiny, small country, small people resisting and defending itself.
Politically speaking, and political part of NATO countries expected basically Milosevic to accept NATO demands after a couple of days of not so serious bombing. And on the other hand, Milosevic here, he thought that after a couple of weeks of bombing that European public opinion will go against NATO and against airstrikes and against the United States.
Milosevic hoped the 19-nation alliance would split. After all, Greece, Italy, and other countries had never favored going to war. For NATO, maintaining unity would become the overriding challenge. And it would test all of the diplomatic skills of the alliance's supreme commander, General Wesley Clark.
From the time we went into this, we had to move from a political dynamic of consensus, compromise, least common denominator solutions, up to a military dynamic that relied on the principles of war: surprise, mass, concentration, focus on the objective, and so forth.
Colonel van Loon.
Hello, sir.
The Dutch commanding officer.
Oh, Colonel van Loon. How are you doing?
Good to see you.
From the outset, General Clark was hamstrung by political directives.
Oh, Chuck, how are you today?
NATO would fight the war from the air, not from the ground.
He'd been a soldier in Vietnam. He'd been an ordinary soldier. He'd come up through the ranks. He knew how important it was to have ground troops. You can only clear ground, hold ground with soldiers. You can't do that with air power.
The German general, Klaus Naumann, was head of NATO's military committee. Effectively, he was Clark's deputy. And he, too, had urged a land force component to the campaign.
We had to understand rather early in summer that NATO nations were not prepared to employ ground forces. And some nations believe, I think, in the illusion that one can fight the military campaign without risking the life of one of our soldiers. And that is, as we all know, it's an illusion.
The administration handled the ground troop issue under extreme pressure, domestic and foreign, with great skill and courage. If we had invaded with ground troops, first of all, it would have taken 3 months to assemble the force. Secondly, if the force had actually gone in, there would have been casualties on the NATO side, which, thank God, there weren't in the real world.
Instead, there was a catastrophe in Kosovo. The casualties in this war would be civilians, not NATO pilots. Hundreds of Albanian civilians would be killed by airstrikes. On several occasions, their tractor convoys were mistaken for Serb artillery. Serb paramilitaries responded to the bombing by committing genocide on a scale not seen in Europe since the Second World War. A response some had expected.
Before the airstrike started, basically from the Serbian side, there were a lot of announcements, and even everybody here, it was kind of a common knowledge, and I think it was announced to the foreign diplomats and mediators that if airstrikes start, that Albanians will really suffer from that.
If you have, as it was the case, 500 airplanes with, I don't know, maybe even thousands of drops of missiles and rockets and bombs on a daily basis, bombing Pristina, bombing Glogovac, Prizren, Orahovac, bombing all major places and towns in Kosovo and Metohija. Can you contemplate the reaction of citizens or population? Would they stand up and raise their hands to the up in order to protect themselves, or they would try to find a safer place?
The signal for the bombing was a signal to Milosevic to get rid of the Kosovo Albanians from Kosovo. And they streamed across the border because the Serbs decided this was the moment to get rid of them. They were being bombed and this was their opportunity.
Having planned for a short war, NATO was unprepared for the hundreds of thousands of Kosovars who flooded out of the province. The unintended consequence of the bombing was to create a refugee crisis. Like so many others, Arvid Demiri realized that only by escaping could he stay alive. He had started to drive towards Macedonia when he was stopped by the Serb police.
They just told me to get out from a vehicle and they asked me which nationality I belong to. And when I told them that I'm Albanian, they start to hit me. And at the end, they took my vehicle and they told me, after this, now you can continue walking to Macedonia. And on our way back, on a building just 300 meters left, I saw a guy with a mask, and when he took off his mask, I recognized him. And when he saw me, actually, we looked each other straight on the eyes, and we recognized each other.
So when he pulled the balaclava off his face, and you saw his face, did you think, now that we've seen each other, he will kill me? Or did you think there's more chance that he'll let me go?
Well, to tell you the truth, I was thinking like he will report to the others, maybe not himself, but he will report to the others and they will take me. And of course, well, my future and my relatives' future will be uncertain.
So your life was decided in that second, really?
Well, yeah, I think so, yeah, about seconds. It was actually between life and death.
NATO leaders, like Britain's Prime Minister Tony Blair, responded emotionally to the refugee crisis, strengthening their advocacy of the war as a moral crusade.
People driven from their homes at the point of a gun. women raped, young men taken out and murdered, a whole people displaced and dispossessed simply because of their ethnic identity. My generation never thought to see those scenes in Europe again.
For the UÇK-a, the Kosovo Liberation Army, which had been battling the Serbs with light weapons for 15 months, the forced expulsion of their people was a disaster, and they wanted NATO to invade Kosovo.
Yes, of course. Yes. We are concerned about it, and I said, every day we wait NATO to come in Kosovo. Because it will be very easy for NATO if we undertake a ground campaign. I know very well Serbian. First day, maybe it will be some difficulties. Just first days, in first line. After, it'll be all of them left of Kosovo.
There's no doubt that Milosevic would have been put under incredible pressure from day one of the air campaign, had he have thought that within a matter of weeks, if not a month, that there would have been ground troops swarming in over Kosovo, because his soldiers would not have been a match for trained professional NATO soldiers.
One thing they did not dare to employ ground forces, because if they were employing ground forces, technological difference so favorable in favor of NATO would be diminished once they are on the ground.
Instead of mobilizing for an invasion of Kosovo, NATO fired up the air campaign and increasingly directed it against the Serb capital, a city over which wars have been fought through the centuries.
In the earlier stages of the war, Belgrade was largely spared from the bombing campaign. When it became clear that the government was being much more resistant to NATO's demands than expected, there was an intensification of the campaign. The aim was to knock out the Defence Ministry headquarters behind me, the army headquarters on the other side of the road, the Serbian government buildings over there. The foreign ministry was here, which suffered quite bad collateral damage. And then further down this street, Knezar Milosevic Street, it sort of became the bomb alley of Belgrade. They hit the Serbian interior ministry and the federal interior ministry, which directed the activities of the police.
These buildings were declared by NATO to be legitimate military targets, in theory. But in fact, these were largely symbolic strikes. Destroying the ministries did nothing to hasten the war. They'd been empty for weeks. Even so, there were victims. Ratko Bulatovic is 40 years old, an opposition party member and a civil defence worker, until his legs were blown off. The night NATO hit the defence ministry, Ratko rushed to the scene, fearful there might be civilian casualties in surrounding apartment buildings.
Šta se desilo? NATO agresor je desetak minuta nakon prvog udara ponovio udar po istom objektu, tako da smo mi stradali od drugog udara koji svakako nije bio očekivan. Ono čega se sećam u ovom momentu i što nikada neću zaboraviti, to je zvuk aviona, zatim jaka detonacija, istovremeno nekako sa tim mene nešto pokosilo od pozadi i pao sam. Pa ja nisam znao da sam izgubio obe noge. Svestan sam da su teške povrede i čak sam nekim krajnjim naporom snage uspeo da vidim da mi jedna noga stoji u neprirodnom položaju, tako reći da je odsečena.
Thank you. Deciding what to bomb was the subject of intense and frequently bitter debate at NATO. The generals had permission to hit military installations, designated Phase 1 and Phase 2 targets. But civilian infrastructure, such as the bridges of Belgrade over the Sava and Danube rivers, were considered Phase 3 targets. Some NATO commanders wanted to destroy them to try to paralyze the economic heart of the nation. France saved the bridges by exercising its veto. For the most part, though, General Clark won the diplomatic battles.
Now, on any individual target, I sort of worked it around through governments. I found which ones wanted to push harder, which ones were nervous, and I tried to pick out the targets in such a way that I maintained support and cohesion. I didn't always defer to those who wanted targets withheld.
One target, which was on the list, then off, and finally back on again, was the main Belgrade studio of the government station, Radio Television Serbia.
We had discussed this issue in the NATO Council, and we had made the point from a military point of view that if we want to hurt Milosevic and to make him blink, then we had to attack those targets which kept him in power. And one of the instruments which kept him in power was, without any doubt, the media and the centralized controlled TV.
On April 23rd, a missile blasted into the television station, shearing off the back wall closest to the nerve center of RTS, the master control room. When we arrived shortly afterwards, they were digging frantically to save a technician buried in the rubble. They failed. Watching on, I thought that it could have been me or the ABC's cameraman, Tim Bates. But this was where we came to satellite our stories. We hadn't been here for two nights. Foreign journalists have been warned by NATO to stay away from RTS.
I was on the mezzanine, and you have upper floor. I was there behind that wall.
Marko Dragojevic was in video editing.
We are broadcasting news, and we heard a huge bang. Only that we felt was a pressure that threw us into the building. My first thought was the simple, pure anger. Why they bomb us? We are just people who work there, and we are do our job. In master control, there was 6-7 people, and they are all, as you know, dead. Some of them friend of mine, 6 years. Only feeling that they have and now and then is the regret because they are dead. They are all young people and boys and girls, you know, from 23 to 25 years old. And we have
NATO struck, it said, to silence a major outlet of Serbian propaganda. 16 civilian television staff were killed.
Šta mislite, zašto su Amerikanci, odnosno NATO, zašto su bombardovali RTS? Zato što je slika onome što se dešava na Kosmetu, o moralu naših ljudi, naročito na Kosmetu, isključivo išla preko RTS-a. Nije bilo stranih novinara da obiđu položaj naše vojske I da vide kakav je to moral.
I think it's defensible to, in military terms, to attack television stations. Morally, there might be a few problems with that, but we again get this tremendous problem of ethics. Was this a war? Was this not a war? As far as I'm concerned, a state of hostility existed.
You see, what wasn't predictable
was at what point Milosevic would toss in the towel. There was never a specific level of bomb damage that could be correlated with his loss of will. It wasn't as though you say, okay, we're gonna, once we take out his house, this guy's gonna give up. Okay, it wasn't the house. Well, what about when we strike the television? Well, that'll make him real mad, but he didn't give up for that either.
In public at NATO's 50th birthday celebrations, the United States and Britain were stressing their confidence in the air war. But behind the scenes, Tony Blair was pushing for a ground option.
Tony was indicating that he had a frustration with the American reluctance to commit ground troops. The British have a different attitude to the Americans to using ground troops. We've had a professional army for far longer, and I think that that was very much the case that British troops, because of their experience in the Balkans, actually knew what they were capable of doing.
In Washington, there were two fundamental reasons to object to that. One was the risk that this would entail, particularly to American forces, which would have to lead any such invasion. And secondly, there was the risk to the NATO alliance, the belief that if you were to raise the issue of ground forces at this stage, NATO might start debating this issue and lose the unity that was necessary to make the bombing campaign succeed.
Milosevic really had the premise that the Washington summit of NATO would lead to a serious quarrel between Western Europe and the United States. He hoped that he would manage to make a gap between Western Europe and the United States, and particularly involving Russia and eventually China in the game. He really thought that he would make a complete mess in the world, which is, as we know here living in Serbia, Milosevic's main political characteristic, to make people quarrel.
Ladies and gentlemen, the leaders of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization.
Milosevic had misjudged the commitment of alliance members to maintaining unity. NATO set aside the notion of a land war in favor of escalating the air war. The number of aircraft was trebled to 1,000. In Kosovo, though, it wasn't working. NATO pilots were barred from flying lower than 15,000 feet so as to stay out of Yugoslav missile range. Consequently, they couldn't be sure whether they were hitting real tanks or elaborate decoys. The Serb TV correspondent Milovan Dretson was the only journalist to see the war up close.
I ja sam sam gledao I snimao sa mojim snimateljem u nekoliko navrata kada je NATO avijacija do iznemoglosti tukla lažne položene.
The inability of NATO to prevent the slaughter of the ethnic Albanians and their expulsion from Kosovo was galling for the NATO commanders. Apache helicopters capable of long-distance strikes at low levels against small Serb units on the ground were dispatched to neighboring Albania, but they weren't allowed to be deployed.
Clearly, General Clark and the Pentagon leadership got during the war, as they had for many times before the war, into something of a tiff over what was necessary. Clark, from very, very early on, thought that you fight a war with all the tools available. That doesn't mean that you only fight it at 15,000 feet, dropping bombs on strategic targets. It means you get the army involved, you get everybody involved in order to put decisive force at the disposal of the commander so he could win. The military and political leadership inside Washington was not prepared to back him on that. They were not prepared to make the case for ground forces. They were not prepared to make the case for flying aircraft at lower altitudes in order to go after tanks and artillery, let alone paramilitary troops engaged in ethnic cleansing.
Instead, NATO's focus was on destroying the industrial infrastructure of Serbia bit by bit. Oil refineries, bridges, roads, the only car factory, even a vacuum cleaner factory. Every big static target was being hit. NATO's objective was to influence Milosevic's circle of business supporters.
a psychological campaign was raised against them, where people would receive faxes telling that their factories would be destroyed within 12 or 24 hours, and telling them that, you know, the next factory won't be destroyed if they could find a way to end this war. And there were a number of ways, different secret and not so secret, in which the United States and NATO tried to influence those around Milosevic in order to raise the psychological pressure on him.
I mean, I'm quite convinced that the attacks in the Pančevo chemical works were not aimed at depriving Yugoslavia of its chemical capability. More likely, they were there because so many of the leadership of the clique around Milosevic actually have ownership of these plants and get considerable income from them. And this was really hitting their pockets rather than hitting the infrastructure of Yugoslavia.
Eskaliranje agresije.
The campaign was what General Clark called high-stakes coercion.
This is the most heavily leveraged air campaign yet seen.
While NATO constantly promoted its successes, privately, as 2 months ticked by, NATO commanders were despairing. What had previously been unacceptable was now on the agenda. Secret planning for a land war was underway. The plan was called Operation Bravo Minus.
That plan was to actually mount a ground attack from three different axes, one in through Albania and two in through Macedonia. In the event, these are actually the routes that NATO troops used in June to go in, the Germans through Albania and the British and French in through Macedonia. But there was a very serious consideration of that, and bringing also S4 troops in from Bosnia, crossing Montenegro if necessary, but at no time actually breaching, if you like, Serbia proper and going into that part of Yugoslavia.
Bravo Minus would have involved in excess of 150,000 troops. The invasion was going to be bloody. The British, who were offering 50,000 troops, anticipated 7% of their soldiers would either be killed or injured.
I can surely tell you, we were very much prepared and to meet attacks, ground attacks from any side, from any quarter, be it north, east, west, be it south, be it only with tanks or with Apache helicopters and so on. We were contemplating such a possibility, and we were very well prepared to meet such a possibility, convinced that it immediately would change proportions of advantages to the wars of NATO.
D-Day was set for mid-September. Then, unexpectedly, in early June, President Milosevic capitulated.
Što se tiče političkog rješenja, ono će biti usmereno ka afirmaciji nacionalne ravnopravnosti svih građana i svih nacionalnih zajednica na Kosovu i Metohiji.
The breakthrough had come during a joint visit by the European Union's envoy and Finnish President Martti Ahtisaari, and the Russian envoy, Viktor Chernomyrdin. Milosevic and his war council were presented with an ultimatum. The Russians, whom Milosevic had always hoped would save him, and the Europeans, told him to give up.
This was quite a long, intense meeting. What I understood, basically, that the Russians didn't even have the text of the NATO demands, that only Ahtisaari had that piece of paper. He gave it to Milosevic. Serbian part of the delegation, they looked at it. One of the members of Serbian delegation, Milan Milutinovic, Serbian president, started to comment on the paper, saying, suggesting that some changes might be done. And Ahtisaari was very clear, saying that absolutely nothing can be changed in this paper, that he just came here to say, to give him the paper and to have answer to be yes or no.
Is it true to say, in fact, that you were very disappointed
in the attitude of the Russian government?
We are, you see, in the field of politics and not emotions, so I would not describe our feelings then or now. We are talking about interests, and it is obvious.
But you must have felt something. You must have felt betrayed, almost.
Russia and Russian leadership obviously thought this was document meeting the interests of Russia.
While the withdrawal of Russian support was a significant factor for Milosevic, so was rising public anger throughout Serbia. NATO had been turning off the lights in Belgrade.
Belgrade, after 4 days of not having electricity and water supplies, living in a permanent fear that new bombs will come and flatten Belgrade, civilian population was really dissatisfied.
Milosevic was determined to preserve his power base, ordering his army and police forces, still largely intact, to retreat from Kosovo. NATO is enjoying its victory. There's a joyous, vibrant air in the Kosovo capital. When the Serbs ran it, I always felt when visiting Pristina that it was a desolate, fearful place. Now, festivals of music and dance are put on by the likes of Vanessa Redgrave. A little light relief for the traumatized Kosovars. It is, though, too early for some to have much forgiveness for the Serbs.
To tell the truth, I don't really care about it. Because I was in the same position just 6 months ago. Well, actually in a worse position than they were now. Because they are, at least they have a UN and a KFOR protection. So, and I was just decided by them. Do I will live or die?
As you drive around Kosovo, you wonder about the extraordinary human cost of it all. The homes abandoned, the families destroyed, and the lives lost in the confusion of war. Hundreds of Albanians and Serb civilians were killed by mistargeted NATO bombs in Kosovo and in Serbia. These deaths were regretted by NATO as being unavoidable in war. Yet all the while, NATO had run a zero casualty policy.
In the end, air power itself did not do what we thought was necessary in Kosovo. For one, air power protected no Kosovar Albanian. 1.5 million people were kicked out of their homes. At least 10,000 were killed. Many, many thousands were raped. Many tens of thousands were wounded and mutilated. And 800,000 were kicked out of the country. Air power didn't stop that. In fact, one can argue that air power and the way we conducted the war may have aggravated rather than contributed to it. In the end, air power was a crucial instrument to convince Milosevic to give in, but only after he had done a lot of damage.
Some nations believe, I think, in the illusion that one can fight the military campaign without risking the life of one of our soldiers, and that is, as we all know, it's an illusion. It will never happen. We were lucky in Kosovo that we didn't lose one air crew member, but that was sheer luck.
KFOR peacekeepers will be lucky to do as well, given the regular confrontations now between the rival communities. The most striking legacy of this war are the graves all over Kosovo. The The war crimes tribunal is investigating 470 mass graves like this one, and more are reported every week. It's arguable whether air power really proved to be an effective instrument for NATO's humanitarian war. In the end, it couldn't prevent mass murder on the ground in Kosovo.